In this demo, I'm going to run through the new facilities introduced in XJ Developer Release 2.6 onwards. And I'm going to do that by working through the Categorized Devices screen for the demo board setup. The 2.6 release introduces using BOM data to match components in your design to device descriptions in a newly added integrated library. Intelligent processing of BOM data and the new Suggest Categorization feature in 2.6 makes board setup faster and easier. For this to work, of course, you do need to make the BOM data available to XJ Developer, so here I'm using the ODB++ description of the board, which has the BOM data embedded. You can still import the BOM in other formats if you want to. To save time here, I've already set the power and ground nets, and I've also worked through the JTAG setup screen. By the way, the new integrated library helps out during chain setup by offering appropriate definitions for any series, resistors, jumpers, etc. But it's in the categorized devices screen that you'll see the most benefits from the new feature. On the left, you see a list of devices unassigned to any category. The checkbox "Only show accessible devices" means we only see the devices that are accessible either directly or indirectly from a JTAG device pin. To get the new Suggest feature to categorize as much as possible, select All Components and then click on Any in the Suggest Select box. That'll ask Developer to try to match every component on the list to the most likely device, searching all parts in the library. And here we have it. In the definition column, you can see that many of the components match uniquely with a definition file from the library. For example, IC6, the ADC. The match found looks good, so we'll just leave the box checked and that's job done. Looking at IC7, the I2C EEPROM, it has a unique match to a generic definition. The EEPROM definition covers different memory size options, so double-click there to configure for the size we're using. On the demo board, we're using a 128-bit EEPROM, so I'll select that and then click OK. The 7400 logic device at IC8 requires the correct package to be selected because it's available in either a 14-pin or a 20-pin package. It's actually the SSOP14 package we want here. Moving down, IC9, it's the SOT23 package we need for that one. Now looking at IC4, the 74245 device, its package selection has defaulted to DIP20. The default is safe because XJ Developer sees that although there are other packages available, in this case they all have the same pin mapping. So for a quick trial setup, I could leave the DIP20 selected and it wouldn't affect the test results. Since I know it's a TSOP20 package we're using, I'll set that as the correct part. Now let's move on to IC3, the flash device. Currently it's only logic device files that support multiple package footprints from within the same single file. Here, for the flash and SRAM parts, there's a separate device file for each package variant, and for different PCB trackout options if there are any. For IC3, the flash part, we're using a 48-pin TSOP package in byte mode. That's just 8 out of 16 data lines tracked out. I'll select that from the drop-down list. As with the EEPROM, there are various configuration options that need to be set. All the information you need to do this should be in the manufacturer datasheet. For the demo board, the manufacturer is AMIC. The device ID code is B5. The flash architecture is asymmetric, in other words, it has blocks of different sizes. The block size at the start of memory is 8K, and there are 8 of these blocks. The block size at the end of memory is 64K, and there are 7 of these blocks. The device does support block locking. The device has been programmed with data in many blocks, so a simple read test of data will find most faults, and will enable flash programming. Finally, from the datasheet, the programming method is word by word with bypass. Click OK to complete that. Moving to IC5, that matches 2 package types in the library, and for the demo board, it's the TSOP that we need. Now let's deal with the remaining passives. Most of the resistors have been suggested as series or pull resistors, and the suggested categorizations look good. It's just R22 that doesn't have a unique suggestion against it because the information available to XJ Developer is slightly ambiguous. Let me explain that. R22 is connected between a JTAG accessible I/O and the ground rail, so that configuration would fit with R22 being a pull-down resistor. Except that, on the other hand, R22 has a low value of 51 ohms. If we classified it as a pull resistor, we would certainly get a false test fail reporting a short circuit to ground. So XJ developer asks the user to intervene here, and in this case we must set R22 as a series resistor. XJ developer will then view the I/O as connected to ground. It'll check that it's low, but it won't try to drive it high. Now we've reviewed, configured and OK'd all the suggested categorizations, click OK on the form, and XJ developer goes away to process all of that. In the status bar you should see that the number of uncategorized devices has dropped from 29 to 16. After running the suggest categorization feature for the first time, you will often find that further parts have become accessible, for example through a logic device or a series resistor that you categorized on the first time round the loop, and then these in turn will also need to be classified. Well, that's the case here. But from this point on, rather than running a suggest loop again, it's probably going to be quicker to mop up these newly accessible devices just by doing a manual assign. Looking at the suggested series resistors, and we'll select those, and I can pick up the correct library definition. It's right there in the recent passives, in the box at the top right. So click on that. Suggested are the resistors. Now R25 is a 1 mega ohm resistor, so I can certainly put that into the ignore category because the value is too high to affect any testing. So just select it and hit the ignore button. The suggest button has done a lot of the hard work for us, but there are still some parts that weren't matched. Now that doesn't necessarily mean that there isn't an appropriate device file in the library, just that a match wasn't made. As time goes by, the matching will only improve as we add more parts and more name associations to the library. For example, the LEDs weren't matched even though there is a suitable library definition. Well, that's a good opportunity to show how to browse the library and to do a manual assign. To manually assign from the library, click Assign As, Test Device, then Other Definition, From Library. And that takes us to the new library browser screen. There's a couple of different ways to use the browser. You can either drill down into the directory tree on the left there, or you can use a fragment of the manufacturer part number or keyword within the search box right at the top. Just while we're here, I mean, for example, the flash memory we were working with a few moments ago, I know the part number contains the number 29, so just type that into the search box. So you see the search tree now starting to narrow. You get the idea. Now there's the flash definition that we actually used. Now back to the LEDs. Part numbering for LEDs tends to be more generic, so I'll just try my luck with LED. Type that into the search box. And there's the file we want. I'll click select OK in the assign form, and that's done. Now back to unassigned devices. Suggest ignore capacitors. These will certainly go into ignore because they're small value capacitors that won't affect the testing. Okay, so select those and ignore. Same thing with suggested connectors. These will have no effect on the testing, so again, select them and hit the ignore button. Now we're down to the last few devices to categorise. We've got Y1 here, the crystal. Again, I know there is a suitable test device definition in the library, so again, assign as test devices. Then other definition from library. This time I'll drill down into the directory tree in clocks and oscillators. See a file there, crystal.xj, and that's the one we want. Select and OK the assignment there. Same for the push button. Just work through that one. Same procedure. This time it's going to be in switches and indicators, and the one we want, pushbutton.xje. Okay, select that, and again, okay on the assignment form. So we're down to the very last part now. JP1, that's the fault creation jumper. This is a special for the demo board, so it's not going to be in the library. You could now go away and create an appropriate definition file for that, but to save time here, I've already put a suitable file in the project directory. So this time it's going to be assigned as passive device. This time we want from file, and that defaults to the project directory. Select that. Job done there. And if I expand the entries on the right hand side of the screen, now we can see that all the accessible devices have been correctly categorized. And that's the setup done to the point where we could do a DFT analysis if we wanted to. That completes this review of the key enhancements in XJ Developer Release 2.6 onwards, notably the integrated library and suggest categorization features. Thank you for watching and listening.